Hi, I'm Graham Steele, CEO and founder of CryptoSense, and today I'm going to talk to you about how to make your Diffie Hellman key exchange FIPS compliant. So why would you want to do that? Well, Diffie Hellman is the most widely used method for doing pairwise key exchange, so the most widely used way to get two parties to both contribute to a shared key that they're then going to use to encrypt some data that they're going to send between each other. You may have used it on your device when you connected to YouTube today. So if you're trying to make your application FIPS compliant because you've got a FIPS audit or you want to sell to the federal government or do FedRAMP or whatever it is, you may have had the experience of putting your cryptographic library into strict FIPS mode and then you find your application crashes when it tries to do Diffie-Hellman. So why is that? Well, Diffie-Hellman is perfectly allowable under FIPS standard. It's one of the approved methods, but you have to do it the right way. There's a special publication, SP856, it's 134 pages, that describes how to do Diffie-Hellman in a FIPS compliant way. But if you're writing an application and using a library that's already got a FIPS certificate, probably the thing that you need to worry about is the domain parameters. So the domain parameters are either the elliptic curve or the finite field over which the Diffie-Hellman operations are going to take place. And in Appendix D of this publication, you can find a list of the approved elliptic curves and the approved groups that you're allowed to use. So where do those groups come from? Well, they come from RFCs that already exist. So RFCs for Diffie-Hellman groups for internet key exchange, that's part of the VPN sort of IPsec protocols, and for Diffie-Hellman groups that can be used in TLS that were already approved. So that's RFC 3526 and 7919. They were already approved for use and FIPS basically references those. However, there's a couple of gotchas. So those old RFCs include groups with 1024-bit primes describing them. So the groups are can be described by the integers between 0 and p minus 1 for a prime p. And those ones that have 1024-bit primes are no longer considered secure just because the groups are too small. And by brute force, we might be able to figure out the discrete log problem for them, which would allow us to crack as an eavesdropper a Diffie-Hellman exchange that we saw. So you can't use the 1024-bit or groups, you have to use 2048 and upwards. In fact, in Appendix D, there is an equivalence given for the kind of security level you need and which groups you're allowed to use. So you need to make sure you're using 2048-bit or and upwards groups from those two RFCs and or one of the approved elliptic curves that also are the same curves that are approved for digital signature, then you're basically good. There is one other method that is in theory allowed for Diffie-Hellman key exchange under FIPS, and that's generating domain parameters using the methods that are described in the DSS standard for DSA signature, but that's now considered legacy construction. If you're trying to get a new application through, that essentially won't fly. There's a whole bunch of reasons. For one thing, you have to prove how you built that group, and that's sort of not really practical for most kind of deployment scenarios. So that's how you get your Diffie-Hellman to be FIPS compliant. But what about the security of that? Well, you may have had the experience of setting up TLS on a web server and then running your TLS configuration through an online checker like SSL Labs or discovery.cryptosense.com, and there you've been given a warning for using a well-known group. And typically, if you look at a how-to online about what to do, it suggests that you generate your own group. So you generate your own new prime P that nobody else is using, probably. And then you generate your own group, and then that's where you do your Diffie-Hellman. So why is that? Well, the reason for that is to avoid what are called pre-computation attacks. So if I know in advance what group you're going to be using for Diffie-Hellman, and I'm an eavesdropper, and I'd like to watch you and your interlocutor exchanging values, and I'd like to figure out what key you're using, if I know what the group is, I can do a bunch of computation in advance that will mean I have less computation to do when I see those values to try and figure out what the final key was. Whereas if you're using a fresh group that I've never seen before, I have to start my computation from scratch, so I can't do that pre-computation. So that's why you're advised by a lot of these sites to use your own groups. However, there are dangers to accepting a group that you didn't generate. For example, there are ways to generate groups that look like they're perfectly valid, but in fact contain small subgroups. And if I contribute the right value, I can force that the final key ends up in a small set of possible values and so on. So there's a number of little gotchas around that. And FIPS obviously decided, the NIST people decided that in FIPS, it would be better to just have a set of known safe groups where we know that the values are good and there's none of these sort of jiggery-pokery going on. And that's a much easier way to make sure that these things are going to end up secure, particularly if the groups are big enough then pre-computation attacks are not really feasible, so we're sort of taking that off the board and we're probably good. So that's what FIPS go for. Anyway, so that's why you might see a different recommendation about your Diffie-Hellman groups if you're using something like SSL Labs to check it than you do when you're trying to run it past FIPS. So if you're trying to get a whole application to be FIPS compliant, you might be interested in our FIPS cheat sheet. So there's a link to that in the description to the video. If you've got a very large application and you want to see a big map of all the cryptography it's using and find out which bits of those are FIPS compliant, what you have to do to get it FIPS compliant, you might be interested in our analyzer tool. So there's also a link to that in the description of the video. Otherwise, do consider subscribing to the channel so we'll keep updating you here about new developments around FIPS, around post-quantum crypto, around cloud crypto, everything you need to know. And I'll see you again soon here for another video.